Okay, holy mackerel. It's been a whirlwind of a week, and I'm just trying to find that some calm. I'm taking some deep breaths all on my own here this morning, so managing everything, so I'm going to try not to get too flustered, try just to breathe. I'm just so glad you are all here. Just delighted that you are coming from all over the world. You've taken your time on a Saturday morning to join me. Questions to answer and just to be with each other. So I'm just so thankful for you all. If you have not watched my video yesterday, you might not know that my son is 100% cancer free. And we're just dealing with that new normal. Like this year has just been so so full of change. I'm just sitting back and realizing four seasons have happened since Cameron was first diagnosed. It happened in winter, we went to spring, we went to summer, and I truly have no clue where the summer went to. And now we're going into fall. So just trying to find a new normal yet again. And I know that you are probably also all dealing with that. I know there's many of you that have children going back to school or grandchildren going back to school. So it is all a time of change. So let's support one another through it. I want to thank everybody for reaching out with all your support. I've received a lot of email and messages in the last couple of days, and I am endeavoring to get back to you all. So thank you very much. So with that, I am going to just jump into the first question. So I've got them all up here on my computer. The first person came from my website, Elle. She's asked, she is a new quilter and she doesn't have a stash to bust. So how does she go about accumulating a stash in COVID? Well, it is a challenge because you're not going to be able to feel them. And part of the love of fabric is touching and just being able to put fabrics on top of one another. It's a challenge. There's no doubt about it. There's no easy answer to this. You're just going to go on your gut feel. You have a color zone that you feel comfortable in, and just remind yourself that it's not just about the colors that you like. You need to find fabrics and colors that support the colors that you like. So maybe a little bit darker, maybe a little bit lighter, or maybe in a totally different color. Like take a look at the color wheel. It may be on the opposite side of the color wheel. Hopefully COVID's not going to be with us forever. And a stash is built on lots of different foundations. So even if you get it wrong, in a couple of years, you'll have a way of incorporating that into a quilt. You'll have more skills to understand how those fabrics work together. And if not, if in 2 years you discover that was totally a mistake, you can make an ugly quilt out of it. I'm not sure if you've seen my ugly quilt video, but it all works out in the end. So don't worry about making mistakes. You can also choose bundles. Like a lot of stores will put together self-curated bundles, not necessarily ones that have come from the manufacturer that way, and you can take advantage of those. Okay, yeah, and there's a couple of de-stash websites that you can go to, or stores are opening up a little bit more now, so you can go to either your local quilt store. I know my own is not open at the moment, but places like Value Village and those type of places are open, so you may be able to get some secondhand fabric. Okay, not a perfect answer. I know you want a solution, but we live in a challenging time, so you just do your best. Terry Dean on Facebook asked, how can she avoid getting her corners sucked into her machine? She's watched my video on Sewing Straight. Hi, Pearl. Cameron's doing well and he's moved back home with Trevor. Sorry for that interruption. That was just the mother of my son's roommate. Terry's asked how to avoid getting those corners sucked into the machine. She's watched the video that I've done on straight sewing and HSTs, and she's followed those tips, and they're still getting sucked into the machine. So part of the problem is if your machine is just a sewing machine, you more than likely have a stitch plate that looks like this, which is very wide. And that is just to allow so that you can do a zigzag or some of the fancier machines, and you just need more space to do that. You may not have a quilting plate available, and a quilting plate just has one hole in the middle here, right here. So what you can do is you can take a piece of tape and you can cover those up and make your opening smaller. You can try that. Depending on how your feed dogs lie, just cut your tape down and just make it smaller so that there's just a smaller opening. And because it's made out of tape, it's going to wear out. You're going to be doing this probably once a month or maybe even once a week, depending on how often you sew. The other solution is to use a piece of newsprint. You probably don't have this problem on all your fabrics. You probably just have this problem with some of your lighter weight fabrics. And just put a little bit of newsprint underneath your fabric as you're sewing through, and you'll tear it off. It's not quite paper piecing, but it just adds a little bit of rigidity there so that that tip does not go down into your machine. Okay, I hope that helps. Julie Reinschmidt has asked, how do you find a guild? Well, we live in a very interesting time. COVID has made finding a guild a little less of a problem because so many of the guilds are on Zoom. So yes, you want to find one locally because that's what you're looking for. You're looking for community. You are looking for friends in the room that like to do the same thing that you do. And that's the best thing about a quilt guild. You walk in the door and you know everybody in the room likes to do what you like to do. So that barrier of figuring out who they are, you all have that in common. So you can talk to them always about it. The downside to guilds is that quilters are naturally shy. Yes, in every room there's usually a bubbly person, and when people are comfortable they're a little bit more bubbly, but that barrier to introduce yourself to another person is high, and you may worry that they're in cliques, and you may worry that everybody's stuck up or things like that. That's truly just shyness. People uncomfortable talking to strangers. So, and you being a quilter, you're like that way too. So you have to understand when you join a guild, you're going to be putting out a little bit more energy than you might be normally comfortable in trying to form new friendships. Don't worry about being a beginner. That's what guilds are all about. You go in and you find these other quilters who have experience. There is a broad range of experience. There's a broad way range of people who like to sew with different styles and different colors. So there's going to be an eclectic bunch of people, and you're just going to have to put a little bit out there. You may have to join a committee. You may have to just find one person that you enjoy being with, or go with a friend. A lot of people join quilts by finding a friend and going together. But I think you'll find them fun. Now, that is for advice for a time when you can actually go out and join a guild. Right now, most guilds, if they're meeting, they are meeting on Zoom, which is wonderful because now you can join guilds in another part of the world or in another city. Or you can just join for a lecture. I have just signed up as a guest for the lecture next week at the Calgary Modern Guild because they have a speaker who's interesting to me. And you couldn't do that before. Before you used to have to travel to conferences and that. So now if you're in Sydney, Australia, you can take part in the Toronto Modern Guild, or I can take part in the London Modern Guild, or, you know, it's just a really fun time. And again, the same rules apply. To meet new people, you can sit there and be quiet and silent in the background, or you can meet new people. You can join a chat room and talk about what you've been working on, because we all have that in common. We can always talk about what quilt we're making. So the last part of that question was, do you audition guilds? She has like three or four in her area, and how do you join? So most guilds have a policy where you can attend as a guest for so many meetings a year. Sometimes that's free, sometimes it's not. Just so you can feel them out and figure out whether it works in your routine as well. Guilds have a personality. Some are traditional, some are modern, some are very committee-based and very charitable-based. So there's an expectation that you belong to something, and some are not that way. They are just about meetings and meeting up on Facebook and things like that. So yes, you audition them. And if you're like a lot of people, you may join one or two. So because they offer different things for you. And it gives you an opportunity to meet other people and get out and whatever. So yes, you can audition guilds. Are they typically welcoming of beginners? Again, goes back to that shy thing. A good guild will have a new member committee, and there's always one or two members within a guild that does make the effort to reach out. But you may, again, I think the biggest criticism of guilds are their cliquiness. People show up and they want to be with their friends. And don't be put off by that. That's just the way some people are. So good luck. Karen Aikenhead has asked, any help with thread nests? She tries to remember leaders and headers when working, and those work well, but it's more with regular sewing. So thread nest happens because for some reason there's no tension on either the top thread or the bottom thread. Just a fun fact, way back in the 18th century, we tried so hard, as the world was becoming more industrial, they tried very hard to invent a machine that imitated that sewing motion. And they didn't, and they came up with a totally different method, which was using two threads, one on top, one on bottom, and the top thread comes down, it twists around the bottom thread, and then comes up. But that system only works if there's tension on both threads. So when a thread nest will happen when either the bobbin thread is loose or the top thread is loose, and that needle goes down, whipping around, and it whips the whole end of the thread around, and it just forms that nest. Now, sometimes you can recover. Sometimes, you know, as the nest is secure, you can keep sewing, but then you flip over your work at the end and you find that little nest there. And sometimes it snaps, it breaks, and you've got to start over again. So the advantage of using a header or a leader or a footer or an ender is that if you're going to have that, it gets buried in that tester piece, that header piece. But more than that, is you want to leave this in your sewing machine. So you want to use an ender when you finish your sewing row, you bury, like it's just sewing along there, and you leave it. So then when you start again, those threads are already attached to something, there's already tension on it, and you can just start sewing what you have. Now, somebody else asked me, I'm going to find that question. Anita Liu has asked me on Facebook whether they always need to be square. And I think by what I just said, you realize, no, they don't have to be square. They can be scraps, they can be pieces of selvages. You do want a piece at least an inch long, because that makes sure that the thread is all buried in there. If you're going to have a nest, it's all taken up. So you want it about an inch long, but you can use all different shapes of scraps. I use squares because I turn these into sampler blocks. I brought a couple here. So I make a lot of four patches. You know, I just make these and then I sew them together. I also do 4.5-inch by 2-inch strips and make a lot of these. And it's just like a bonus block. And it's just incredible how many you can make while you're making another project. So they're just used with my scraps and they just grow over time. I'm not making a specific quilt. I often incorporate these blocks into backs because I have so many. I if you saw my last video, my vlog, you know, I had an orange quilt, I had to make an orange back, so I just went into that stack of sampler blocks and pulled out everything that was orangey, purpley, and I sewed those into a strip. So that's why they are square. So, but they don't have to be. A lot of people just use crumbs, and you can do long pieces of them, you can do short pieces of them, you can just choose what you want to do. Okay. Somebody asked, when pulling these for leaders and enders, do you separate them in lights and darks, or do you just grab whatever? I separate them into high value and low value. I try not to overly curate it, but I do try and make that effort. So like these ones actually look alike, but they were not pulled to be alike. Here are two other sets that I just sort of have, like these four. You know, I even incorporate holiday fabrics into them. But then I always, when I do these, I press to the dark, and it just means that I have a consistent sewing, pressing, and then I would make a four patch like that. But these are just coincidentally gray and pinkish. I choose all sorts of different colors. I do not curate them for color. Light, dark, and pattern. Like, I would not put a dot next to another dot. I would put a dot next to it, like a square. Like, this is a weave. So those are the only choices I make when I choose them. And then some days I think I'm overthinking this. I'm just gonna do whatever the next ones are in the pile. Okay. Clotide Fernales has asked me on Facebook. She is starting a new quilt. She has to make HSTs, and she's instructed to draw lines on beforehand, but she's been told to draw on the dark side, and she would prefer to make these marks on the light side. Is there any difference? Well, I'll just go back to what quilting fabric is. Quilting fabric is a very bright, you know, we have these very intricate patterns on them, but they're printed on the top of the fabric. They're very rarely woven in. So on the back, you have this grayish side. So I don't sew on a lot of light volume ones, but even when I do, I will mark it on whatever side is most visible. I use a variety of different marking pencils. I use pencils, I use friction pens, and in a couple of cases with some dark ones, I've used some, like I've used chalk. I think some people can use soap. So if you're a beginner, do what feels good, because beginner quilts are all about learning. I don't know how dark the fabric is that you're using. Certainly, I would not use a black pen on a white fabric. The chances of that showing through are just too high, but I wouldn't hesitate to use a lead pencil on a light fabric, because that will just, it's easy to wipe away. It's really what it comes down to. So if it makes sense for you and it's not showing up when you're pressing them, go for it. Brenda Griffin from Facebook has asked, she's working on a paper piece quilt, and she wants to know how long I leave my papers on until I take them off. When you're working with paper piecing, you're often your pieces end up on biases. So that means that they're very stretchy. So I try to leave my papers on as long as I possibly can so that my blocks retain their shape as I'm working with it. That said, you do not want to get nests of paper, which happens when you sew seams with paper to another block with paper. So what you want, I just have a piece here. This is a paper airplane by Christy Lee. It's a free pattern you can download from her website, Quiet Play. This is a really good pattern for beginners. It's a great pattern for learning how to work with value, because obviously the dark shadows are where you want your darkest fabrics, and where the light is shining down on the paper airplane is where you want your lightest fabrics. But I would take this paper pattern and I would trim off those seam allowances right there. That's how I work with paper piecing. I cut off that seam allowance to begin with. And then I add in a quarter, like I have a quarter inch ruler, but sometimes I'm just measuring a quarter inch with a ruler. And I trim a quarter inch from the paper, and that way I can keep the paper on longer once I've sewn the blocks together. So that is my answer. You do not want the situation where you're sewing these two pieces together, because when you fold them over, the paper that's underneath here is very hard to rip out. You think you're going to do it, you think it's going to be easy, you think you're going to be very hard at work ripping that out, and it is quite difficult to get into those nooks and crannies. So that's how I work with paper piecing. Do I have a paper piecing video yet? I do not. But I would recommend Sugary Do has a number of really good ones, and she's actually starting a paper piecing class, a four-week class. So go over to her channel and take a look at that. If you make one of my patterns, the Stashbuster patterns, is there a place where you can post a picture? At the moment, not. If that's other than going to Instagram and putting the hashtag Stashbuster Quilt or Stashbuster 1, 2, 3, 4. I think I'm up to 6, and next week I'm going to have a 7th. You can also tag me on an Instagram post and I can see it there. But if that's something that you would like, maybe I could put an album on this page and you can post your pictures there. So just put your comments down in the notes and I'll see them there. Thank you. I would like some advice on getting seams. This is Michelle. This is from Instagram, and she's asking for some advice to get seams to lie flatter in the middle of pinwheels. So when you have a four patch and they're coming together, when you fold everything over, you have four pieces. Like that middle piece is getting bigger and bigger, but with pinwheels, you've got eight pieces. So it can get quite bulky there. So the solution to that is to spin your centers. I haven't done a video on that yet, but I will in the future. I think what I'll do is I will take this into my next Quilt Coach episode, because it's a little hard to show how to spin them in this type of format. So just look for the next Quilt Coach. Froggle629 has asked on Instagram, how do you get sharp points when you turn out your fabric? Part of that is realizing you are working with fabric and there will never be a perfectly sharp point. It's just the nature of fabric and the medium that you're working with. You want to clip your points. You can go down to, at the point itself, you can go down to 1/32 of an inch. And then the last thing is you want to use, I've shown this in my video on pillows. The name of the video was Quilt Worthy. And I showed how to use this tool. Now, the tip of this tool and the tip of a regular, like a cuticle stick, there's not a big difference between the two of them. So you could use this if necessary. But what you want to do is when you flip it out, you take your stick or whatever and you start halfway. You don't want to be just going in and then poking at that corner. You want to lay it down on your seam and then push it along the seam out to the tip. And you want to do it on this side and you want to do it on this side. And you'll probably find your results get much better. But again, it's not going to be a sharp point ever because of fabric. And the thicker the fabric, the softer that point's going to be. Lily Idaho has asked on Instagram, says, some people say you can, and some people say you can't on mixing cotton and pre-cut batiks. The issues seem to be bleeding and more importantly, different shrinkage rates. What are my thoughts? Well, when people start saying can and can't, the people that are saying can't are telling you that you are going to get more consistent results if you stick to one fabric. It's not about can't. This is your hobby. You can do whatever you want. But when they're saying can't, they know that there's just more management that you have to do with your fabric. Shrinkage is a big one. When you are mixing different types of fabrics together, shrinkage is the main issue. So if you've pre-shrunk them, then that's not an issue. The difference between quilting cottons and batiks are often, there's a finer weave in batiks. And that might mean that you need to use a different thread, or that might mean that you need to use a different needle to get through that denser fabric. But that said, there's millions of people that incorporate both of these fabrics in a quilt. You know, just grabbing a piece here or a piece here that they need the fabric. There's also a lot of people that take white Kona cotton and combine it with batiks. So it's definitely been done before. You just need to spend a little bit more time in your practice piece to be sure that you've got the right thread, you've got the right needle, and you're getting the results that you want. Batiks also, the comment about bleeding is batiks often have a little bit more color in them, so you've got to be a little bit more careful when you wash them the first time. So yeah, so there's no such thing as can't. It just is, it usually just translates into you need to have a little bit more mindfulness in what you're putting together. The next question is also about fabrics, comments on using different fabrics. She has some donated fabrics. Some have a bit of a stretch, some have a more stretch, some are thinner, some are thicker. Trying to use them in projects, but they definitely impact her accuracy. Do I have some tips? Again, there's no such thing as can't. You can combine all the fabrics together. You just need to be more mindful and be more flexible with the type of results that you get. If it's a knit, if it's a definite knit, I would always stabilize it with something. I would stabilize it with just a lightweight interfacing, just so it's easier to use. You know, like if you were trying to quilt organza next to denim, I should say those are challenges that you're going to have to look into. How is it going to work? You might need to use some tissue paper to help stabilize that organza. You might need to have a larger seam if you're sewing the denim or a heavier weight. So take the time, do the practice pieces. There is no fast, quick, all-encompassing answer, but by combining fabrics, I love combining fabrics. I think you get amazing results and beautiful, beautiful quilts are out there when you combine fabrics. So stabilize the stretchy ones, play with your stitch length, play with your thread, and just also know that there's more ways than one of putting fabric together. You don't always have to sew a seam. Sometimes you can applique it on top. You can do raw edge applique. You can do turned edge applique. You can do raw edge sewing, like it's so common in denim. So have fun. Have fun. That's a wonderful journey to be on. What is next? Thread can be expensive. Is there a less expensive thread of good quality? Thread, you got to look like at thread as end needles and rotary cutters as the oil that runs your engine. Yes, we don't think of anything of putting gas in the car. We know that cars need gas, but cars also need oil. And the better quality of oil you have, the better your engine runs. So I know there's no bling attached to thread. There's no rotary cutters and needles. It's just one of those costs of sewing. So there are lots of good brands out there. And there's the higher level ones and the less expensive ones. And you'll see the results in your sewing based on which ones you do. So I always ask for thread for Christmas or birthdays. I ask for rotary cutters. I ask for needles. Those are things that I consume all the time and I know I need and you know you need, and people are often looking for things that you need for gift giving, so that is where I ask it. And I don't use my best thread on all projects, so you can have a hierarchy of threads within your sewing room. I use on almost everything Sewfine. I have these in about 7 different colors. I have beige, I have an orange, I have a blue, I have a lime green, and this is the majority of my sewing. Then I have Aurifil. I have a Tulip Pink Aurifil collection. I have some other Aurifil collections, which I will do when I'm looking for a different result on top. I'm looking more for color matching that I need. So don't scrimp. Don't think that you're ever going to find a free or nearly free thread. Just realize that there is a cost that you need to allocate in your budget to the rotary cutters, needles, and thread. Part of it is acceptance that that's part of the cost of sewing. Somebody asked me, I think I've got time for about one more question, and somebody's asked, Raven Smoke Dancer. I hope you're here, Raven. Always love good comments from you. One of the local fabric ladies told her that cheaper fabric will mess up her machine due to the fluff and dust, and the same with cheap thread. Is it true that it will mess up her machine? The base of quilting cotton and thread are cotton, and they produce fibers, they produce dust, they produce lint, which is pretty well all the same term, the same word. But the cheaper the fabric, the more that they'll produce because they're using shorter fibers. And that just comes off so much more easily. But just having more fluff and lint is not going to damage your machine. What's going to damage your machine is that if you do not clean your machine, because you're going to have dust and lint with the good stuff as well. So you want to get yourself into the habit of cleaning your machine on either a daily or weekly basis, depending on how often you sew. And you want to oil your machine according to the directions. And again, based on how much you sew, you will need to take it in to be professionally cleaned once a year. Again, based on how often you sew, it'll have to be done more for some than others, because there's dust and lint that gets back into the machine. And, you know, I've seen pictures of machines that have been opened that look like they have never, ever been cleaned. I also go through, you know, I'm going, oh, when was the last time I cleaned my machine? I'll open up, and I cannot believe how much dust has accumulated underneath. So just make it into your habit. Yes, overall, you will get so much better results if you use the good stuff. But that doesn't mean that using the cheap stuff is going to give you horrible results. The cheap stuff can make beautiful quilts that are loved by many. So do what you can afford. Keep trying to say there's no such thing as can't. This is your hobby. You do what you can do. And do what you like. You know, you're making quilts for you as well as other people. So don't try to be forced into another zone just because it's the thing that you must do. And I am just going to answer one last question. And people have been asking me, what is this quilt right here? This is the Circus Tent Quilt by Laura Henberry of Commonwealth Quilts. And this is one of my most favorite projects that I've ever done. You know, I love working with color. So this was just right up my alley. And you can download it from our website. It's not free. It's not a free pattern, but certainly worth it. And it comes in different sizes. So you can make a crib size. You can make a cuddle quilt size. You can make a twin and king. I have done my wide binding on it. I just thought that because there was so much color on it, it needed a wider binding just to keep the colors together. And I did a multicolored a variegated thread, because I've never met a variegated thread I don't like. If I did it again, I probably wouldn't do the variegated thread. I was advised ahead of time, but I was in a rush to finish it. I probably would go with a light yellow or like a very pale blue or something like that if I did it again. And one last question, just because I'm holding it. People are asking about the quilting to look good both on the front and the back. Do not worry about what the quilting looks like on the back of the quilt, especially if you're a beginner. If you're an expert and you're going into shows and things like that, yes, you can make the extra effort. Fabrics migrate as you're quilting them together, so it's just not something that a beginner should be trying to do. It's just not you think it's a big deal. I have a quilt at home where I thought, oh, it's just going to look so bad. The front of the quilt was all custom made. It's amazing how it ceases to be an issue. So, because the front gets all the attention. So, anyways, thank you so much for showing up today. It's been a roller coaster couple of weeks, and I'm just so happy to be with you all. And thank you for all your support. It's just been lovely. And I cannot say thank you enough again for all of it, helping keep me strong when I really, really needed it. So what's coming up? If you haven't seen my video yesterday, it is my vlog. It's how I kept busy in the last 6 weeks. Well, we were waiting for my son's test results. I made an announcement there. In 2 weeks, I'm starting a interview series called Karen's Quilt Circle on my YouTube channel. It starts on September 21st. My first person I'm interviewing is Anita Zobins of Threadworks. So she's going to tell us about her journey. She's going to tell us about thread. And she's an amazing quilter and woman. So I can't wait for you to see that interview. And next week I have Stashbuster number 7. Fast, easy, fun quilt. So I hope you join me. So take care and I'll see you next time.